beautiful presence of the Holy Ghost here in this house today. Nothing like being at home. Really wasn't much of a tender-hearted person. So I started matching people. I don't know if it's because they do bad or what, they make you cry. Instead of getting a burden for them, you love them. I can tell you today and tonight, my heart is as excited as I've said. One chapter closes, another begins. But I'm encouraged by the prayers of the saints that will lift me up and encourage me. I know you've been standing a little while. Give me just a moment. To my pastor and his wife tonight, thank you. I honor you. Cherish our friendship as well as your pastorship in my life. If you don't have a pastor, you need one.
Amen. That's right.
Brother and Sister Wise are here, mentors of my life as a young man. Thank you, Brother Wise, for loving me. Papa and Mama Wise for being there for me when I was a 19-year-old boy and didn't know which way to go in life. They opened their home up to me. I lived with them while I was dating Sister Warren. Some of the greatest times of my life. Many a conversation on the back porch and the words of wisdom of Papa. They're learned it will get you in trouble. It was their home, and I'm going to be a little comical tonight, but it was their home that I was staying with. I was dating Sister Warren, and after 3 months, I finally got a little peck, a little kiss, you know. I run in the house, Sister Warren left, and I run in the house. I dove in Papa Nana's bed. Papa said, "You got some sugar, didn't you?" I said, "I did." He said, "That's my boy." God's people are wonderful. And if you can't laugh in the house of God, you need to pray through the altar somewhere. Even Paul, when he was on his way to Rome, he told Agrippa, he said, "I think myself happy." Sometimes you just got to smile. And that's another lesson for another time. To Brother Holly, my friend, that he used to preach me when I couldn't preach my way out of a wet paper bag, still can't today. Thank you for putting up with me, Brother Holly, and allowing me to preach and take care of your church. Good friend. Friend of our family, thank you. I honor these men of God because they all have a peace in my life, a handprint in my life. And I thank them tonight. Thank God for this church family in Oil City. I speak of you far and wide. And tonight there will be many tuned in from Hobbs, New Mexico, and to them I say I'm thankful to be part of that church family, what God is doing there. Amen. Please continue to pray for revival there, that God will give us souls for the kingdom. If you have your Bibles tonight, I would like to direct your attention to Philippians chapter 1 and verse 6. Joining me in June. I can't wait. It's hard to pastor a church without your wife. It's not easy. Thank God and give me a good soul. Amen. I thank God for my friend Dennis Johnson. Publicly, I will say, he has heard a lot of rants in his life from me when I just need to voice my opinion. than it's for being a close friend. Philippians chapter 1 and verse 6. Being confident of this very thing, that he that which begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. In other words, if he's coming or you die or whatever, he will perform that work in you. We're confident in his word today that he is going to finish the work in your life. We're encouraged by the word that says that he'll never leave us nor forsake us. Amen. Lord, we ask you to bless this message tonight. I ask you to anoint my lips of clay. Anoint my spirit today. Open our ears of hearing, our heart of understanding. Let the power of the Holy Ghost generate in this house and illuminate into this community. Let your anointing flow. Tear down every stronghold. Break every chain. Set free those that are captive. Let the anointing of the Holy Ghost have free course and free will in this house tonight. In the name of Jesus. Give the Lord a great hand clap of praise. He's worthy to be joined. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you for standing in reverence to the reading of the Word of God. Listen to me and my folly. I want to preach for just a little while tonight. A new normal. A new normal. Normal is conforming to a standard, usual, typical, or expected. We all have a normal. Normal is how we respond to situations. Normal is what people expect of us in given parts of our lives. Normal is our spiritual condition. It is our disposition. It is our character. Within our normal is our expectation of life. Our normal is our dreams. Our normal is our hopes. Our normal is our desires. It's what satisfies us and causes us to be happy. It's normal. We all have a normal. Each of ours is different, but in many ways they are alike. If you would write down on a sheet of paper your normal, the question rings, what would it say? Would it say, I'm hopeful? Would it say, I'm expecting? Would it say, I am happy? Would it say, I am satisfied? Engaged in life, whether whatever or normal is, John chapter 10 and verse 10 says, the thief cometh not but to steal, kill, and destroy. But Jesus said, I come to make you normal.
Right, man.
I come to make your normal better than what the enemy desires to do in your life. Jesus described it as more abundant.
Right.
Some weeks ago, I was listening to a story from an elder in our church, and he was telling me about a gentleman that had worked in some small community somewhere up north that he had known, and he called the names of the towns. I couldn't pronounce them if I wanted to. But as he began to go through this story with this gentleman, the gentleman said that he took some stuff to the gentleman to fix, a blacksmith or whatever it may have been, or the story passed down or how it was. But I remember in the story, he began to say that this gentleman had never been out of his community. 10 miles down the road was another town that he called, I forget what it was, but whatever the town was, it was an Amish name, and that gentleman had not even been to that town. All of his life, he was probably in his 30s, he said, all of his life he had lived in that township. And during his life, that was a normal place in his life. He did not, apparently, his world was pretty small. He didn't travel much beyond his farm and church and the business that he needed to visit there in town. In fact, he really could not tell the gentleman anything about the other surrounding towns around him. Amen. It's all he had ever known was his little town. Amen. If you would tonight, we could say Orange Sport. Never been to Old City or never been to Shreveport. Just in the township of Orange Sport. His religious beliefs and way of life kept him isolated from the rest of the world. So his normal is very different than mine and your normal tonight. Yet it is his normal way of life. And I am sure tonight, enjoyed his normal. It all seemed very simplistic and serene in a way, as this gentleman began to tell me, actually. But we are not really talking tonight, amen, about the normal in our lives or how far we've traveled outside of Orangeport or Oil City or Shreveport or Vivian or Ferry Lake Road. But we're talking about our spiritual condition and God's desire to give us a new normal in this generation.
All right.
Someone might say, I don't like my normal spirituality. I wish things could be different. I wish I could be closer to God. I wish I knew Jesus on a new personal level, in a more personal way. I wish my life was different. I wish I could serve God with everything inside me. I remember as a young man, amen, in my freshman year of high school, I went to the weight room like every other young man and dropped down on the bench, and I thought I was somebody. And I benched, I don't know what it was, probably 150 pounds, and I thought I was stout. And the upperclassmen began to laugh and make fun of me. But during the course of my high school years, during 4 years, amen, I began to get a new normal. Every time I would lift weights, I was gaining strength, and I would get a new normal. It would take me to another level. And by the time I was to graduate high school, my normal would far exceeded where I started in lifting weights. Amen. Yeah. My normal kept increasing. My normal kept growing. Amen. When I began to bench my max as a senior, my eyes were open to the understanding that the more I conditioned myself, the stronger I become. That's why we cannot separate ourselves from the house of God. That's why you can't separate yourself from a prayer room somewhere. That's why you can't separate yourself from pastoring and reading the Word of God. You have to stand and be in preaching in the presence of the King, because there's coming a day when you're going to stand accountable for your relationship with God. I realized where I was the week before in conditioning and lifting weights. We had guys in here that do that on a continued basis. Amen. They're dedicated to it. But where they started years ago, it's not where they are today. They're much stronger. Can I tell you, when you were born again of the water and spirit, it didn't stop there. But every service you came to church, you lifted your hands, you magnified God. Took a while, but pretty soon I was past my original normal. See, here's where many people trip up in their walk with God. They think that normal has to stay normal.
Right.
But they can't grow beyond where they're at today.
All right.
They are stuck in a routine. They're stuck in life. They're stuck in their walk with God. Unable to move forward. Trapped right where they are for the rest of their life. But aren't you glad tonight you know who Jesus is? We live a normal life. We go through the routine of life. Amen. I know that about 4:45 in the morning, that Sister Warren's going to wake up and her little feet are going to hit the floor and she's going to be wide open. But I also know that about 8:30 at night, amen, the lights are going out and she's going to sleep. I come to tell somebody that in the normal, I know everything about her. I know how she operates. The devil understands your normal tonight in your relationship with God. He knows you're going to be in church. He knows you're going to be faithful to the house of God. He knows you're going to feel the goosebumps, but he also knows you're going to leave the same way you came and carry that same burden and walk through the same trials, because he's got you on his radar, because normal is just normal to you. But when you decide to break off the weight that easily beset you, lay the sin aside and say, God, enough is enough. I know how to have church. I've been through the mechanisms of having worship and praise. I know how to sing and bring the glory down, but I haven't tapped in It's not in my notes, but I'll tell you what I did the other night. Pastor, I did something probably like you would do. Amen. We pray in our sanctuary, and we run about 50, a little over 50 people. And I was down praying, and the lights came on. The rest on, I know he's going to do it. And the lights came on, and everybody went about their routine. They went to the piano. I didn't tell the piano player what their fault. She went to the piano. Everybody else, amen, was just getting ready to do their thing. I kept praying. See, I was trying something.
Uh-huh.
I just kept praying.
Right.
And after a while, I realized, I looked up, and they were just sitting there looking at one another like knots on a log. And I thought to myself, they've developed themselves into a routine.
Come on now. That's right.
Amen. They developed themselves into a routine. And you don't believe that the enemy don't realize your routine, you're wrong. But when you choose to get out of the routine, and yeah, I preached on it that night. I come to tell you tonight, you don't have to come to church and go through the same whole routine time and time again. But what you can do is say, God, I'm looking for a new normal. I'm looking for a new normal. I'm not going to stay the way I am. I've got to be changed. I've got to be stirred. I've got to be set free. Man, so we're stuck in life. We're stuck in the rut.
Right.
Aren't you glad you know the one who come to give us life and give it to us more abundantly? Amen. And more abundantly. See how? Amen. See, here's the deal tonight. There is no one but there is no one but you who puts limitations on you tonight. Your life is simply that. It's your life. It belongs to you. You control it. Pastor can't make you have a prayer life. Pastor can't make you fast and become more spiritual. Pastor can't make you read the Word of God. All he can do is preach the Word somewhere in your spirit. You got to get a hold of this relationship with God for yourself and say, God, I've had enough. My family, if I tell every day this should be, then you need to make a stand and say, hey, I'm tired of the normal. I'm tired of fighting cussing with my family. I'm tired of barely getting by. But I gotta have a new normal in my life.
Amen.
I don't put any flowers on myself because I'm nobody. But on Tuesday night of last week, Monday night of last week, I apologize. I asked to go to a prayer vigil because they're trying to take our Ten Commandments down in the town.
Right.
When I arrived, we have a lady in our church that is, she's on steroids for Jesus. All I can tell you. She's on legal speed for Jesus. She had talked the lady that had organized it into allowing her pastor to lead the prayer. Unbeknown to me. I get there, there's like six or seven other pastors in town. They've been there longer. Me got bigger churches. We're across the tracks, you know, so to speak. We're in a rough part of town where you got to put cameras outside. I like it. Amen. You got to have cameras outside to make sure they don't break in your cars during service. Amen. We got safety team running around. Amen. They lock our doors 15 minutes after service. And if you want to come in, you got to send me a text or send somebody else a text to let you in. Or you got to come stand and look at the camera until they recognize you in the sound room. I come to tell you tonight, amen, I begin to pray. And I begin to talk to the Lord. I began to pray. I was nervous as a cat on a tin roof. All these people standing there. And I began to pray to the only name I know, Jesus. And as I began to pray, this spirit of holiness, and before it was over, amen, I was leading around. And then the town hall, the ladies in our church were speaking in tongues and holding their Bible, telling everybody about His brother Terry said, "I gotta have a drink." You look at me and tell I like tamales and tacos. You gotta make a difference. You control it, you decide your destiny. And what you do with your life is up to you.
Oh, yeah.
You can stay in spiritual apathy if you want to, or spiritual war and sport locked in around the little town and never go outside the city limits. Hey, amen. I'm not knocking Moore's where I live over there. I'm using that symbolically tonight. Hey, amen. If you like to never growing outside of the box, so to speak, never maximizing out a new level in Christ, never going beyond the borders of where you already have been, or you can choose a new normal tonight. You can decide that tonight, amen, something's going to change in my life. Something's going to change in my life. That new boundaries are going to happen in my life. Amen. I'm going to see new horizons that are going to be reached in my life in the spiritual realm. That's why you were here tonight when you woke up. Amen. When you woke up at this service, and all of a sudden you begin to realize the Spirit of God was moving, because all of us walk in here in the spirit of carnality, but our eyes opened in the spiritual and we realized that God was in the house. I don't know about you. I don't want to ever be said that I didn't know Jesus was in my presence, but yet I entertained His Spirit and never left changed or renewed or challenged to reach the lost.
All right.
Jesus doesn't do normal. Things up with the religious folks of that day, doing things that for hundreds of years they never even thought of doing, like healing on the Sabbath. They said it was blasphemy, but He healed him anyway. Eating and drinking with sinners, what does that do? It stirred up the religious sect of that day. Amen. And I might need to behave a little bit, but walking down the road sometimes of our life, we pass people and we look down our Pentecostal nose at them and we don't even say a word to them. I have been guilty of doing the same thing. But I was the little lady in the church. Amen. I want to publicly apologize to my pastor for not teaching many Bible studies here, because being in Hobbs, I've taught a lot of Bible studies since I've been there. I've learned what it is to reach out to somebody distressed and in need and not look on the outside, but as Jesus does, look on the inside and realize they're hurting and need God. I want to tell you tonight, amen, I've watched them as they taught Bible studies. I watched tears flow. I watched that little lady teach Bible studies the other night, sitting out for you, teaching Bible studies to two that she used to shoot up with. And last Sunday night, I baptized both of them. You know how to make it happen.
Right.
Brother Brady can tear the tambourine up till somebody runs out. Sister Jody can sing until somebody jumps pews or jumps chairs. You know how to do it. Brother Anthony Brown can smoke the keyboard until the smoke's coming out of it. Or the piano.
Right.
We know how to do it. But we end up being the same old singer.
Oh, come on now. Come on.
Come on.
It's more for me than probably anybody. But in the last 2 weeks, God has put this in my spirit. And I have studied it and studied it. And I said, God, somewhere in my life changed me. God, let me realize I had my hat on the death, burial, and resurrection. And that was not normal. It's not normal for a man to get out of the ground after 3 days. And yet I live this life as a normal Christian, as a normal saint of God. I may call myself apostolic or Pentecostal, whatever you want to hang on your name tonight. Amen. But when I went down in a watery grave and I came up a new creature in Christ, there was nothing normal about that. But yet as I live my life and I get so far away from my birthday of the Holy Ghost, I learned how to have church. I learned how to pray. I learned how to do this and do that and make it all look good. But on the outside, I may look the
right.
Age and size. And I'm going to tell you something. Hell wants to destroy everything that God ever planted in him. And there's some things in his life, and I'm not trying to embarrass him, but if I'm going to stay normal, politically correct, I will never step through the realm of the supernatural, and he'll never get his breakthrough he desires. I come to tell somebody tonight that if you want a breakthrough, amen, you know somebody needs a breakthrough, why don't you put your arm around